for loving us. Love us, especially to today's message. We'll thank you for this in Jesus' name. All God's people say, amen. You may be seated. I mentioned earlier that we're starting a new mini-series from the book of Hebrews in the month of December, and just trying to take some very choice verses that are found in this book to encourage our hearts. I just feel like there's just so many things in here that speak to us, and of course, foremost of which, it speaks is about our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm reminded by that Charles Spurgeon, years ago, as he was preaching from the Word of God, he says, he's opening up God's Word one day. He says, I have just one goal, and I want to preach to you Jesus Christ is my goal this morning. And that's really the goal of the book of Hebrews, is to present to us Jesus Christ and who he is. The writer, who I believe is the Apostle Paul, there's much debate about who the writer is. Some believe it could have been Barnabas. Some believe it's Paul. I think if you read through the book of Hebrews many, many times and you contrast or compare the book of Hebrews to other of Paul's writings, I think you find some similarities. I think you find the signature Paul over the book of Hebrews. But God didn't want us to get into debates and arguments about who wrote it as much, because really the writer of the Word of God is God himself. Amen? All scripture is given by inspiration of God. And so we know it's God-breathed. And I think God wanted us to just really focus on the message of Hebrews, because he starts off in verse 1 with just God. There's no introduction. There's no really just, you know, greeting of any kind of nature that's kind of familiar with the writings of the Apostle Paul, the Apostle John. It just starts off God, because really the beginning of all things is God. The importance of all things is God. And so he writes this to us because one of the key words, of many key words we find in the book of Hebrews, is the word endure. The word endure is found 7 times. This is written to believers who are fainting in their faith. They were, they were backsliding in their faith. They had just departed from where they used to be. They were not going in the same directions they did before. This grieved the writers. We read through all of Hebrews. This grieved them that they were not walking by faith, but they were walking by sight. They were walking a life that was not victorious, something God wants us to have. God wants us to have a victorious Christian life. In fact, he said, this is the victory that overcometh the world, even your faith. He said, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. So we look at the book of Hebrews, and he tells us that the importance of endurance, but he casts it in the light of this way. He gives us the benchmark for endurance, the prime example, the number one example for endurance, and that's the person of Jesus Christ himself. He said in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2, we're to look unto Jesus, who's the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of God. And he said in verse 3, consider him which endured such contradiction of sinners, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. It is easy for God's people to get discouraged. It is easy for God's people to faint and be weary in their hearts and their souls. It's easy for us to get out of our routine. It's easy for us to get out of the routine of being in church. It's easy for us to get out of the routine of reading our Bible. It's easy for us to get out of the routine of praying. It can be easy for us to get away from these disciplines that are so necessary for the faith, for our faith to grow. And we can find ourselves getting discouraged by circumstances, getting discouraged by environment, getting discouraged by friends, getting discouraged by the words of people. We can find ourselves in a place where just many different things distract us and discourage us. But Paul said here, the writer says, we must consider him which endures this contradiction of sinners. As we consider the Christian life in the light of Hebrews, we must consider him. We must get our eyes upon Jesus and look full in his wonderful face. Hebrews tells us in the beginning here, God at sundry times and in diverse manners spoke in time past unto the fathers by the prophets. Now before Jesus came, the Lord used prophets to bring us the message. Sometimes he used angels to bring us the message. But he brought prophets, men like Moses and Elijah and Elisha and Isaiah and Micah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Zechariah. He brought us the prophets. He gave us men of God who gave us the word of God. But he said, since those times, Jesus has come. And he says, in these last days, he's spoken to us by his son. Now, in the Old Testament, we have the written word. But in the New Testament, through Jesus Christ, we have a living word. Jesus is the living word. He came to us in flesh and blood, yet without sin. And John so wonderfully describes it in the Gospel of John. He says, in the beginning was the Word, capital W for word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God. We scroll down a few verses later to verse 14. In John 1:14, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glories of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. False teachers infiltrated the Jewish places of worship, the places, the local churches where these saved believers were, who were going strong in the Lord, and it convinced them that their faith was incomplete. They convinced them that Jesus was just an angel, or Jesus was not, it was not a savior, Jesus was not God. They convinced them that they needed to adhere to the Jewish practices. For the men, they had to adhere to circumcision. For the everyone else, they had to continue to follow the Jewish example of the feasts and the ceremonies, the Day of Atonement and the Passover, the sin offering, the trespass offerings, and all of those things. And because of all of that, there was confusion. These believers started to fall away from God. That's why he wrote this to them, because they got discouraged. The writer writes very strongly to us about the importance of looking at Jesus Christ. And so we look at chapter 1, and we see very strongly, beginning chapter 1 until we get to the end of chapter 13, the emphasis is on Jesus Christ. As we consider him, we're going to see three things in our study. We're considering Jesus Christ in his deity, that Jesus is God. We're going to consider Jesus Christ in his death, that his death, his atonement is complete and sufficient and satisfied all of God's demands for sin. We will consider him in his deity. We'll consider him in his death. We'll consider him in his dominion, that Jesus Christ is King of kings and Lord of lords. He is God and God alone. He is absolute. He's chief authority. He's the captain of our salvation. He's the high apostle, the great high priest. He's Jesus Christ, who's God. He's the great shepherd of the sheep, who through the blood of the everlasting covenant makes us perfect, complete, to do all the will of God. He's the God of peace. He's the God of comfort. He's the God who saves. We're going to see Jesus on that this morning. I say to you today, as we look at this, Jesus Christ is God's son. Notice this morning, as we consider him, he's God's son, number one, who is sovereign. He's God's son, number one, who is sovereign. The word sovereign means absolute, all-powerful, in control. He's king, he's preeminent, he's supreme. In summary, sovereign means Jesus is God. Jesus is completely God. Jesus totally God. He is God. I like what Charles Spurgeon said about the deity of Christ. He said, whatever God is, Christ is. The very likeness of God, the very Godhead of Godhead, the very deity of deity is Christ Jesus. Now, he's sovereign. He's God, creator. He's creator God. Look at verses 2 and 3. God has in these last days spoken unto us by his son, whom he's appointed heir of all things. Notice his next phrase. By whom also he made the world. Verse 3, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power. Automatically, we right here, right up front in chapter 1 of Hebrews, Christ is presented as creator God. He made all things. He holds all things together. We think about the galaxies and things that spin in orbit and how God holds all things together. We think about how God made all things to happen. The Bible says the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day utter speech, and night unto night knowledge. There's no language nor voice where their voice is not heard. There's no language or knowledge where their voice is not heard. Jesus Christ is creator God. Look at chapter 1, verse 10. The writer said this, and thou, Lord, that's God the Father speaking to Jesus Christ. Thou, Lord, in the beginning has laid the foundations of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thy hands. Jesus Christ is creator God. In John 1, 3, it says, all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Colossians 1, 16 says, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible. Visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were made by him and all things are for him. Jesus Christ is the creator of all things. All things were created by him. This does away with any notion that anything that was made were made by things which appear. It does away with the notion that man had anything to do with creation. This does away with any notion that what is here came by chance. As creator God, he established order. As creator God, he made all things beautiful. As creator God, he made all of us and everything for a special purpose. As creator God, he's the originator. As creator God, he made you and he made me. He is creator God. Years ago in the country of Russia, government officials would visit the countryside and visit the farmers specifically to examine their crops and get their opinion about the soil and the outcome of things that year, things of that nature. And one of the potato farmers out there got his routine annual visit from one of the government officials. The government official came to this potato farmer and he said, "Comrade, tell me about this year's crop. To which the farmer replied, "Oh, sir, it was wonderful. It was so big, it reached up to the very foot of God." The communist government inspector, of course, did not take very well to that response. And he had a furrow on his brow. And he said to him, "Comrade, this is a communist state, and we are atheists. You must not forget, there is no God." To which the potato farmer immediately replied, who was a believer. He said, "But sir, that's just the reason I'm bringing that point up. That's just my point." He said, "No God, no potatoes." And mind you today, no God, there's no creation. No God, there's no world. No God, there's no you and I. No God, there's no potatoes. Jesus Christ is sovereign, is creator God. Jesus Christ is being sovereign, is co-equal God. He and God the Father are one and the same. Jesus is not lesser than God, he is God. He's not greater than God, he is God. He and God are co-equal. That's an important part of our understanding of the doctrine of God, the doctrine of Jesus Christ. It's the co-equality of God the Father and God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Look at verse 3. It says, "Jesus Christ, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person." Colossians 1:15 said of Jesus Christ, "who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature." We read in John chapter 1, verse 1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the same was in the beginning with God." Many years ago, back in the day, Oakland Airport, if you can imagine this, did not have security. You could walk in off the street, and you could walk down into the gate. You could walk with someone into their gate and wait until they boarded their plane. And the church I got saved in, their teen group had a service project one particular Friday night. And so in that service project, we loaded up about 3 or 4 15-passenger vans. Every one of us had about 50 to 100 tracks with us. And our goal was to go throughout Oakland Airport and circulate and give tracks to people. And of course, the young people were all fired up for God and just excited about the Lord. We all took tracks and ready to go, had our New Testaments with us. And we said we're going to look for opportunities to witness to people. And I remember making my way through Terminal 1, which now is called Terminal 1, making my way through there, giving tracks to people. I came up to this gate. I don't remember the gate number. I just remember it was on my left-hand side. There's a distinguished-looking lady that was standing there waiting for her plane to arrive. And I went up to her and I said, "Ma'am," I said, I'm from this particular church, and I'd like to give you something to read. It's free. May I give this to you?" And I presented to her like this. I said, "I'd like to give this to you to read." And she looked at it and looked at me, and she said, "Well, yes, I'll be glad to take that." And she started reading it. And I said, "Ma'am, do you go to church of any kind?" She said, "Yes, I do." And we took a clipboard with us and used what we called a religious survey to kind of engage people in conversation. She's kind of walking through questions that would lead to the major question you wanted to ask a person. That is this, that if you were to die today, do you know for sure you're going to heaven? And I got that question with her, and the lady just kind of got a little cold with me. She said, "Well, son," she said, "I want you to understand something." She says, "I'm a Jehovah Witness. I don't believe the same as you because Jesus Christ is just a man. He's not God." And I said, "Well, ma'am," I said, "do you have your Bible? Do you have a Bible in there?" You know, the Jehovah's Witnesses don't use the same Bible as we do. They use what's called the New World Translation. It's not the Bible, just so you know that. It's called the New World Translation, and there's nothing new. It's all worldly, amen, you know? And so she opened it up, and she read we went to John chapter 1. I said, "Read to me what you have in John chapter 1. She read to me chapter 1, verse 1, but she did not read verse 2, because in the New World Translation, look what it says. It says, "the same was in the beginning with God." The New World Translation doesn't have that. I read to her John chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. The Word In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Because that part was omitted out of their book too. And I said, the same was in the beginning with God. And she kind of stumbled, didn't know what to say. I said, ma'am, the Bible is the Word of God, and Jesus is the living Word. And the Bible says here, Jesus is God. He's the Word. God is Jesus. Jesus is God. I remind you today, Jesus Christ is Creator God. He's co-equal God. The Bible says the same was in the beginning with God. Now, what do we mean by co-equal? Jesus said this. It says this. He told the believers, he said, he that has seen me has seen the Father. He's the brightness of the glory of God, the expressed image of his person. Now, there's a couple of things we see about the co-equality of Jesus Christ and God. Number one, they're co-equal in their essence. Essence means who they are and what we are and what they are. Jesus Christ and God the Father are one and the same. He's the brightness of his glory. And if you would, he's the express image of his person. Jesus Christ is not God with a little g. He's God with a capital G. He did not become God. He is always God. He's not becoming God. He is plainly always God. He's co-equal in essence. He's co-equal in eternality. Listen. Jesus Christ is self-existent. He was before all things, and by him all things are the same. The Bible says in Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. Look at verse 8 through 12 here. Verses 8 through 12, we'll just read three of the verses, speak to so clearly about the eternality of Jesus Christ. Look at verse 8. But unto the Son he saith, now the he is God the Father, but unto the Son he saith, this is a quote from Psalms 110, thy throne, O God, here's God the Father calling God the Son, God, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Go down to verse 10, and thou, Lord, in the beginning has laid the foundation of the earth, and the heaven are the works of thy hands. They shall perish, but thou remainest. They shall all wax old as doth a garment, and as a vesture thou shalt fold them up. They shall be changed, but thou art the same, and thy years shall not fail. Jesus Christ is eternal. He's forever. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. God is eternal. He's the everlasting God. He's the everlasting Father. We can thank God this morning for his eternality. He is continuous. His years fail not. He's forever and forever and forever. Listen, you and I are going to change. You and I are going to we're going to age, and we're going to get older, but God and Jesus are always the same. Your car and my car, our models will get outdated. They'll go old. They'll become obsolete. Jesus never grows old. Jesus never goes obsolete. We thank God today. He is forever and forever and forever. Thank God for that. He's co-equal in his essence, co-equal in his eternality. He's co-equal. Notice verse 3 in his effulgence, his brightness. He's the glory of God. We beheld his glories of the only begotten the Father, full of grace and truth. He's co-equal God. He's creator God, but don't lose sight of this. He is completely God. He's not less than God. He is completely God. Colossians 1:19 says this, for it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. In every form and fashion, he's God. He's God the Father. He's God the Son. He's God the Holy Spirit. He's holy, harmless, separate from sinners and undefiled. He's holy. He's righteous. He's grace. He's all truth. He's all wisdom. He's all righteousness. He is completely God. He's able to do all things. He's completely God. Listen, as we study our scripture this morning, the writer wants to know, Jesus, God's Son, is sovereign. He is God. But notice secondly, go back to chapter 1. Notice verse 4, please. Jesus, God's Son, is superior. Look at verse 4, please. Being made so much better than the angels, as he has by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Now, we have a contrast that the Bible is doing here, chapter 1, of Jesus and the angels. The Judaizers were saying, some said he was an angel. Some said he couldn't be God. He was a man. And because he was a man, all flesh is evil. And so if he had flesh, he couldn't be God. But the Bible tells us, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. Jesus Christ is superior. He's so much better than the angels and so much better than the prophets. Now, how is it that he's so much better? Well, he's so much better because of his preeminence. Preeminence means that he's first, he's foremost, he's chief authority. There's none above him. Angels are created beings, but Jesus Christ is creator. Angels are called in Scripture sons of God with a little s, but Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus Christ, by right and by inheritance, the Bible says, is the heir of all things. Angels are not the heir of all things. By the way, we as believers in eternity will judge the angels. Angels are created beings. Angels, if you would, are spirits. Look at me at verse 6, 7. The Bible says, he maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. Jesus is preeminent over angels because angels worship Jesus Christ. We go to Luke chapter 2, verses 7 to 9. We read about the heavenly hosts, the angels, worshiping Jesus at his birth. We read over in 1 Timothy 3:16, he was seen of angels. He says here, let all the angels of God worship him. The angels worship Jesus. Angels are ministering flame, are spirits and ministers of flames of fire. He said in verse 14, are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation? Jesus is better than the angels. Consider with me this. In verse 4, it says that he has obtained a more excellent name. Now, the Bible tells us this in Acts chapter 4, verse 12. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name given among men under heaven whereby we must be saved. No man, no person can be saved through the name of an angel. We must be saved through the name of Jesus Christ here. Angels are less than Jesus. Angels are created beings. Listen to this. The name Michael, which is an archangel, Michael means who is like God, but Michael is not God. The name Gabriel means the man of God, but Gabriel is not God, the God-man. Jesus Christ in preeminence is greater than the angels. He's preeminent over angels. He's preeminent over the prophets. You think about the prophets. There were some great prophets. There was, as we said earlier, there's Moses and Elijah and Elisha. There was Micah and Isaiah. There was Zechariah. There was Daniel and Ezekiel and Jeremiah. But all the prophets are less than Jesus. I think about the Mount of Transfiguration there on Matthew 17. Jesus, he transfigured himself, standing next to him were Moses and Elijah. Moses and Elijah worshiped Jesus Christ. They acknowledged Christ as being the one who's God. The prophets were messengers, but Jesus Christ is the message. The prophets were great men, but Jesus Christ is the God-man. The prophets had their failures, but Jesus never fails. The prophets were limited, but I remind you this morning, my friend, Jesus Christ is unlimited. The prophets were lacking, but Jesus is Lord. The prophets were men who brought God's message, but Jesus is the message. I remind you today in Deuteronomy 18:15, the chief prophet with a capital P is Jesus Christ himself. He's the only one that can lay claim of being prophet, priest, and king. The Lord thy God shall raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me. Unto him ye shall hearken. Jesus is so much better than the prophets. Jesus Christ is so much better than the angels. He's so much better than religion. He's so much better because of his preeminence. But listen to this, he's so much better because of his performance. Look at verse 3, please, again. He's the brightness of the glory of God. He's the express image of his person. He upholds all things by the word of his power. And he by himself purged our sins. Jesus Christ, in his supreme performance, the chief reason why he came was to die for the sins of every man. But God commendeth his love towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, and we are sinners, and we've fallen short of the glory of God, sin must be paid for. The wages of sin is death. The soul that sinneth, it must die. It is appointed to men once to die, and after this is the judgment. We are all sinners. That though we were sinners, Christ died for us. For us. He took our place. He was our sin substitute. He's so much better because of his performance. Paul even said, much more than being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. And he's so much better in his performance because look at Hebrews 2:9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. I remind you this morning in his performance, Jesus' blood was shed for your sins and mine. Jesus' blood is the only blood that can wash away our sins. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I remind you today, only the blood of Jesus can wash away our sins. The Bible says in 1 John 1:7, it tells us the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin, past sin, present sin, future sin. Listen, the blood is efficacious. The blood atones for us. It is precious blood. It is purifying blood. It is powerful blood. It is his blood that was shed for you and I. By the which will we are sanctified by the offering, the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Hebrews 10:10. Jesus Christ bore our sins in his body on the tree. The Bible says he was the just for the unjust that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the spirit, but justified in the, being put to death in the flesh, but justified in the spirit. Jesus Christ is performance is so much better. Let me tell you this morning, there is no prophet that ever lived that could give his life or even gave his life for the sins of man. Jesus is the one who gave his life for us. There's no high priest that could give his life for the sins of the nation of Israel, because he had to make an offering for himself because he was a sinner, as well as an offering for the people he represented. But Jesus Christ is our great high priest. He's the only one that that definition is given to, that he's our great high priest who represents us, who came not for his sins because he had no sin, but for your sins and mine to die for us. He was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. In his performance, he tasted death for every man. But I tell you this morning, Jesus died for you. Jesus died for your sins. He paid the sin debt. He satisfied all of God's righteous demands for your sins and mine. And he's the propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for the sins of the whole world. His sin, and when he died on the cross, he satisfied all of God's demands for sin. In his performance, Jesus Christ is much better. I'm going to tell you this morning, he's much better than baptism. He's much better than confirmation. He's much better than church membership. He's much better than a religious affiliation. He's much better than whatever money you have. He's much better than your wealth. He's much better than your wisdom. He's much better than your intelligence. He's much better whatever way, whatever concept or things people try to concoct. He's much better because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but through him. You know, people get befuddled sometimes. They say, well, I have this faith, and I have this, and they think that. But I remind you today, what makes Jesus Christ much better. It is nothing you can do to save yourself. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. It's not what you can do or what you can do. It's what he's already done. It's completely finished and done for completely for you. If you just put your faith and trust in the fact that he's so much the better because of his death on the cross for you. So much the better. He's superior. He's so much better because of his preeminence. He's so much better because of his performance. But let me bring it down to home. He's so much better because he's personal. He's a personal Jesus who wants a personal relationship with you. He's not so out there. He's not so ethereal that you cannot have a relationship. You can have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. He's so much better. He's so much better than anything we could buy or purchase or do. You know, we live in a world filled with marketing and merchandising and hype. You know, one of the big hypes we're dealing with the last several years is the hype of the electric vehicle. First, there was Tesla, which came out, and it was kind of the benchmark for electric vehicles, and miles ahead of Ford and GM, and now you've got its rivals, other competitors like, I think, was it Rivian and Lucid, and I think another one that's coming out the third quarter of next year that supposedly has a superior battery than all the rest of them, and it's going to have much longer endurance and so forth there. You know, all of them keep claiming they're better. Let me tell you this morning, Jesus Christ is better than electric vehicles, amen? He's not so much better. He's better than atomic power because he's the source of all power. He's so much better than any kind of form of energy because he's the source of all energy. He's so much better than all intelligence because he is the intelligence. He's so much better. He's so much better than our educational institution. He's so much better than a school. Listen, we live and die for all these different things. We wear ourselves out to get our children the best education. Let me tell you, the best education you give your child is an education in Jesus Christ. He's so much better than the education institution. He's so much better than pursuing wealth. He's so much better than the world. He's so much better than all of these solutions that people are trying to bring. He's so much better than global climate because he controls the climate. Hey, look at chapter 1. You want to know what's going to happen with global climate? You want to know what's going to happen to the world? The Bible tells us right here, God holds all things together. God tells us here, in chapter 1, it says in verse 10, God laid the foundation of the earth and the heavens are the work of his hands. Notice what God says here about the earth. It's going to perish. But God remains. God remains. He's so much better because he's everlasting, amen? He's so much better. They shall wax old as does a garment. I was out sowing the other day with one of our men, and we came to a very sincere lady, and she started crying and weeping because she said, you know, we have ruined this world, and we've ruined this earth. And he said, this world is dying. And I said, ma'am, it is dying, but God is the same. This world may die, but God is the same. He's going to make a new world. He'll make a new heavens, a new earth there because he's so much better. As a vesture, thou shalt fold them up. They shall be changed. You and I are going to change. But he's the same, amen? He's so much better because he's sovereign God. He's so much better because he's the Son of God. He's so much better because he's our Savior. He's so much better because he's the same. He doesn't change. He doesn't get obsolete. He's always the same. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's always the same. Jesus Christ is so much better. He's better than your pocketbook. He's better than your credit card. He's better than your wisdom. He's better than your intelligence. He's better than your wealth. He's better than your cars. He's better than your jokes. He's better than anything you offer, anything you could do. Why? Because Jesus Christ is God. He's so much the better. He's personal. He's the Savior of every person who calls on him for salvation. He's the God. He's God's mercy and grace when we come boldly to him, to the throne of grace. He's our anchor, steadfast and sure for our eternal security. He's the captain of our salvation. He's the stability that we need in a world filled with instability. He's our example for endurance. He endured such contradiction of sinners. He's the water of life for everyone who's thirsty. He's the bread of life for everyone who's hungry. He's our calm when we're in the storm. Listen, he is our rock on which he stands. He's our refuge when we look for hiding. Jesus Christ is so much the better this morning. Notice chapter 2, if we go down a little bit further, it tells us this, verse 17, 18. Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. He is able. Jesus Christ is able. God can do anything but fail. Amen. Jesus Christ can do anything but fail. He is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. He's able to answer our prayers when our prayers are in alignment with his will and our life is clean of sin and we keep his commandments and obey him. Listen, he's able to answer our prayers. He's able to do the impossible. He's able to help us walk by faith. He's able to help us endure our sufferings and our calamities and our difficulties. He's able to help us get through the next day. He's able to help us have faith. He's able to give us strength. He's able to help us overcome our temptations. Listen, it doesn't matter what it is. He is able because he's all powerful. Jesus Christ is able. He's so much the better because Jesus is superior. Jesus Christ, God's Son, he's sovereign. Jesus Christ, God's Son, is superior. Notice again, chapter 1, verse 3. Jesus Christ, God's Son, he saves. He saves. He saves. He saves us from the condemnation of our sin that will send us to hell. He saves us sufficiently. He saves us completely. He saves us thoroughly. He saves us instantly. He saves. That's his very name. He saves. Jehovah is salvation. He saves us from our sins. He saves. If you're not saved this morning, you need to get saved. If you die today and Jesus Christ not your Savior, you'll spend all of eternity in a place called hell. That's not where God wants you to go. Jesus Christ died to save you from your sins. Jesus Christ is so much better because he saves. November 26, 2008, a gang of Islamic terrorists invaded the Taj Mahal Palace in Mumbai, India. One of the great terrorist attacks that happened years gone by. People from all over the world were there that day. Many had filled the restaurant, were eating with friends, travelers from the United States, England, other parts of the world. Indian nationals were there. Everybody went to the Taj Mahal Palace. It was famous. Security was very light. No one expected anything bad to happen. Nothing had ever happened before. This group of terrorists came in. They rushed in with automatic weapons, high-powered weapons. And all people could remember is there was the sound of automatic gunfire going throughout the room, and the whole room upon room upon room, floor after floor after floor, being sprayed with bullets. An Indian-born English actor was among many of the guests who were in the dining room that afternoon. Sitting there enjoying a meal with several of his friends, Indian-born English actor miraculously found himself alive. The news outlets heard about this man, and they rallied to speak with him and ask him, how is it out of over 200 people who died that you survived and you're still alive? How is it, sir, that you're alive and you can speak, that you're alive and you could testify, that you escaped being hit by a bullet? How can you explain that? And he said this. Listen to what he said. I suppose it was because I was covered in someone else's blood and they took me for dead. I suppose it was because I was covered in someone else's blood and they took me for dead. My friend, this morning, if you're saved, you're covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. You're saved. When God said in Exodus chapter 12, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. When God looks at you and I, he sees the blood that covers us. You're not dead, but you're alive. Jesus shed his blood so that your sins could be paid for in full. The most wonderful gift you can receive is the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Are you saved this morning? Do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? I'm not asking if you've joined a church. I'm not asking if you've been baptized. I'm not asking those things. I'm asking, can you remember a time and place you repented of your sins and you said to God, I know I cannot save myself. And I come to you to tell you I have faith in the death of Jesus Christ and shed blood and paying the price for my sins, and I accept him only as my Savior. If you've not done that, this morning we give you that invitation. We give you the invitation to trust Jesus Christ, to receive him today as your Savior. Christian friend, do you see Jesus Christ as Scripture presents him? He's much better. I mean, you're not going to have answers to prayer if you don't see him as much better. He's much better because he's God. He's much better than anything you own, anything you are, anything you ever hope to be. He's much better. What a crave for Jesus as the greatest jewel that anyone could own, as the pearl of great price, as the one who loves you, the one you need to love, that you adore him as he seeks to love you. Would you let him love you this morning? Would you draw near to God and you let him draw and you draw near to him? Would you let him draw close to you? Would you trust in the Lord this morning as a Christian to walk by faith and not by sight? Let's stand. Heads bowed and eyes closed.